Okay, got it.
And it makes life simple. And then at the bottom of your screen, there should be a video picture with a red line through it. And if you click on that, then you will come up and we can see each other talk. How about that for modern life?
Okay, so at the bottom of my screen, there is...
There should be like a, it looks like a, over on the left-hand side, at the very bottom. There should
start
be
a video.
Yep, start video, and up you should come.
Okay. There we go.
Oh, there you go. Life is good.
Wow. All right, good deal. Good to see you again.
It is wonderful to see you. How have things been for you since I saw you back a week? Was it a week and a half ago?
Yeah, about a week and a half ago. Good. Missed seeing my son down in Arizona a little bit, but that's all right. He'll be home in another 10 days. My daughter, Taylor, just started basketball, coaching basketball at the high school level. So that's been kind of a busy run around. So everything's good. Life's good. So dogs are quiet for now and no phone is ringing. And so it's kind of windy and cruddy out. So this is a great time.
Super. So I have several thoughts for you, okay? One is I'd like to set up a time when I can actually officially interview you, and we'll do it on a format called Webinar Jam so we can keep putting it on social media.
Okay.
So I just want to look at what we want to do with that and how we want to do it. But so here's a thought for you. I don't do this. I've only done this once, I guess, and it was for my mother's friend. But if we can make this somewhat valuable and useful to you, then what I would be glad to do for you as a gift to you is to spend an extended period of time one day, record some of what you want to record of the stories of your coach and mentor that were really important to you that you wanted to have written down. And what I'd be glad to do is help you with that. We'll record it, have that transcribed, and then you can do whatever you want to with it. But then you have it for yourself. So I just think from that brief conversation that you have some really valuable things to share, and people would love to hear it. So.
Okay. Well, it's interesting because as I was thinking about this whole thing, after we're done, you need to write this down. The chicken runs at midnight.
Chicken runs at midnight, okay.
The chicken runs at midnight, and the author of this is Rich Donnelly, D-O-N-N-E-L-L-Y. Now, I'll give you some background about Rich Donnelly.
Rick Donnelly or Rich?
Rich.
Okay.
Well, Rich Donnelly was my coach in Pittsburgh. He was, okay. Jim Leland was our manager. Rich was a coach. And
Who was that? I'm sorry, go back and say that again.
So Rich Donnelly was a coach. When I was with Jim Leland in Pittsburgh, you know, Jim was our manager, and Rich Donnelly was our coach. He was our third base coach. So Rich Donnelly.
This is when you were at Pittsburgh.
Correct.
Okay.
Obviously, we've all been friends, but, you know, Rich Donnelly and I are very close. And when you do some research on him, The Chicken Runs at Midnight is about his daughter. It's a great story. And actually, it just got published in a book. And I don't even know if there's a movie coming out on this.
Oh, wow. Uh-huh.
But Rich is a motivational speaker and travels all over the country. You think I have stories? There are stories that he has that really needs to be recorded. He has stories upon stories upon motivation, personal, professional. He is really a special man. And you think Jim and I are close. Rich and I are probably as close. But as I was thinking about this, this might be something also that, I mean, I don't know if you're comfortable doing, and that's a lot of work, but I mean, if you're comfortable for your own resource to be in contact with Rich, I haven't called him yet, but I was going to ask you first if you wanted me to get you in touch with him. I mean, Rich is retired now, but there's so much information that Rich has to share with the world about Jim Leland. I'm just a small totem. I'm just a small little pig. Rich has got the full tree.
Okay.
He's been with Jim for so long. Anyway, it's something that I thought I would pass along to you.
I would love to interview him. Yeah, no, please share my name with him and give him my connection and ask him. I would love that.
Okay.
You know, I think here's the issue. I think, and this is what I learned in working with my mother, helping her write her book after she became blind, and then with her concentration camp friend, is that when they're gone, the stories die with them unless somebody has taken the time to record them. And I think many times we think, yes, someday we'll do it. Or we think it's, you know,
yes.
How do we organize it, right?
Correct.
And I've now done this with two people, my mother and then with her concentration camp buddy. And so I have seen the incredible value of it. So, no, I would love to.
Okay, great. I will pass it along and I'll be in touch with you and see what his response is, because he is, when it comes to the tip of everything, he is the guy. And then everything else filters down below him regarding Jim and his wonderful life and how many people he's touched in his life. And you might be biting off more than you can chew, because I'm telling you one thing, this guy's touched a lot of people. But you're right. This is something that needs to somehow, some way, either be A, recorded, written down in a book. Something has to be done. So anyway, we'll start today and we'll see where this goes.
Okay, so I kind of divided things into three parts from our conversation. And you can change it. You can look at it any way you want to. What I want to do today is to figure out the template, and then we'll come back and record.
Okay.
Okay. I am recording this.
Okay.
Just so you know, because it gives me the opportunity to think after we're done. But I thought the three big umbrellas could be: what are your life lessons that you learned? Looking back at your life before baseball, during baseball, after baseball, especially now that you have an incredible gift with your son also being in professional baseball, what is it that you absolutely want him to be able to have, that you would like him to have as his base, so he doesn't have to discover everything that you did? I mean, what are those core things that you think are so important you want him to have? Because that's sort of what people want to know from you as well, right?
Correct.
And then the second is some of the lessons that you learned from Jim Leland. And then third was what you've learned about sports for children, and what's the role of sports, and how do we navigate that? So sports actually becomes a tool for a child's growth and development rather than something that can end up diminishing them because they're not good enough.
Correct. Yeah.
That's so right. Those are the three big things. And I thought when we do the webinar, what we'll do is divide it into three. When we get through the one, we'll stop the recording, start the next, and then the next. So there's three totally distinct videos. That way it's easier for us in terms of production at the end.
Okay.
And then the other thing is, so then, then you can just start thinking about the things that you really would love to share that you want people to know, because those are the stories that I'll come back and pick up for you that you can do something with.
Sure. Okay. I'll have to do some, it's so much easier to flow as we talk as opposed to trying.
Okay. So let's go through and do an outline for you right now, and then it'll be easy. And I'll have the outline, and I can just ask you the questions.
Okay.
Okay. So which of the three would be easiest for you to begin with?
Probably the youth sports one would probably be the easiest today.
Okay. Let's start there.
You know, almost 20 years ago, my wife and I developed this, our Gary Varsho Baseball League. And with the intention of our children who came with me to spring training in Clearwater, Florida, as I was coaching in the minor leagues for the Phillies, they were involved in their little league program. And we had a wonderful time. Obviously, getting out of the Midwest and Wisconsin when February and March is ideal. So going down there, our kids had a chance to play, and we met some wonderful people, and they accepted our children, and they had just a wonderful time. Socially, they grew as individuals because they had to make new teammates, a new surrounding. It was just absolutely fabulous. And obviously, once I left for the season, which is the beginning of April, then they would return back to Wisconsin. And obviously come back to the Midwest where it's a little muddy, a little snowy maybe yet. And so there was this lapse of time from April through June until my children were out of school. And then they would come and join me wherever I was at. And most times it was in Reading, Pennsylvania as a double A manager. So we did this one year, and all of a sudden the second year went by, and my kids asked me and my wife, Kay, about possibly, can we do something in the spring? Can we play baseball in the spring? These are all elementary kids. And I said, well, I guess we could try to do something. So my wife and I, we tried to ask people if they were interested. We created a sponsor, we created a league, and we ended up having 8 teams, 2 9 and 10 year old teams, 2 and 11, I'm sorry, 4 9 and 10, 4 9 and 10, and 4 11 and 12. And people in the community loved it. It was something different. It was an idle time of the year where there was really nothing to do other than, because it was such an idle time of a block of time, because, you know, elementary kids never had a chance to play spring sports. It was always in the summertime. And so what I just tried to create was an environment where I grew up, because when I grew up here in the same small town of Marshfield, Wisconsin, we didn't have spring baseball when we were little, but we also had summer baseball. So I just try to recreate this great league that we had when I was growing up in this community, and just trying to reinvent it, because what ended up happening in the summertime here in Marshall wasn't the same quality of program that I encountered. Well, obviously, as time wore on, more people became interested, and 8 teams exploded into 24 teams, and people really enjoyed that block of time. And it was about assembling the teams was really about, okay, we want to make sure that the schools, the elementaries of Washington and Lincoln and Jefferson and all the schools, they had a chance to stay together, because recess is a very important part of a young person's sort of day-by-day education at school. Because if Johnny and Jimmy are on two different teams at recess, it'd be nicer if they were on the same teams at the same grade level, because, hey, we're kind of buddies, and that's your buddies going through. And so we really try to make this work. And obviously, we didn't give out any ribbons. We didn't give out any trophies. It was all about a community, a really small community, getting together and going out there and really enjoying a way to have a team-orientated but really a fundamentally based baseball program from an educational standpoint. We didn't have standings. We didn't have batting averages. We just try to really learn. So the process kept developing where we tried to become better teachers. I took my expertise, what I could teach to our coaches. I learned a lot more from a great infield instructor, Perry Hill. And Perry taught me a lot more infield, just sharing knowledge along the way. And hopefully we get a nice, our numbers would grow to the point where eventually kids decide whether or not baseball is for them. Or if it's a girl, we've had females in this. Both of my girls played in this league. And they just love playing with the boys. So there are some females that coexist with our program. So as time went on and things became really great, all my kids were basically flushed out of the system. They were all older, but we maintained this league because the interest was so high. And we had developed a really good relationship with a lot of sponsors in town, and they really enjoyed this. And again, we only had a spring season. Summer was basically designed for whoever wanted to play tournament ball, soccer, hockey. You can go on your own, but this was just our kind of like our space of time.
April to June,
right. When school was out, our season was over. So as time went on, parents seemed to change. They wanted more of a A team and B team. The better players are segregated in playing, and the lesser players are segregated to B team. And they came to me with this proposal, and I said, well, isn't it interesting? Now, at a very young age level, and this is a small entity, but it's nationwide,
yeah,
that we are going to decide already when they're 8, 9, 10 years old, that we are going to decipher between who's best and who's secondary. Because realistically, in our society, it's okay to play with everyone, no matter what the skill level. Because part of our responsibility as parents and youth coaches, number one, is to make sure that we are all good teammates, no matter what age level. And it's okay if we have a young boy or girl, if they end up striking out. We want that best player to be up there saying, it's okay, you'll get him next time, and vice versa. It's okay for the best player to sit out, which they have to do in our league. They have to sit out an inning. You need to watch and cheer on your other teammates. So we have a lot of different things that we try to make sure that teammates matter. Alan Williams, who is an author, writes this book, Teammates Matter. And I know I'm getting off on a but he writes, it's about his college experiences and Chris Paul, and it's a wonderful book. But what I took out of this book was he has also written some other articles, and it talks about the dinner table and what really goes on at the dinner table. So my point is that, and I know I'm rambling a little bit, but realistically, having all these A teams and A teams and A teams, we never allow these other kids to try to catch up in their age. I mean, so if we constantly take the strongest, the best players at their, you know, January, February, March, April, those birthdays compared to October, December, of course those kids are going to be behind, but they're in the same age level. So if we continue to let them play, let them develop, and let's see, because kids' interests can vary all the time. All right, so I'm trying to get to my point. I'm trying to make sure I get this well-rounded. So anyway, the worst experience I had here was all of a sudden our varsity coach, who was a head baseball coach, decided that he was going to have his 8-year-old team and he was going to make cuts. And I said to his face, I said, you can't allow that. How are we so smart that we don't know that an 8-year-old 5 years from now is going to develop? You're already cutting kids that we need in our program. We need volumes of kids. But yet, the point is this. We need moms and dads that go and support all the kids. I get the A team, I get the better skilled players, but eventually they'll come to the top. And we don't know about that little boy that could really use the help from another teammate that might end up being a nice little, has a great journey through his middle school years, through his high school years, and we gave him an opportunity to be part of something. We're not chasing the college scholarship. We're not chasing the major league dream. We are talking about little people, little youth who should be having fun. This is about fun. It's okay to have good games, poor games. The other part of this whole thing is that what our league does and what I hope would hope our society would understand is the amount of value a parent can share with their child because they allow them to play, and whether good or bad, when Johnny strikes out two or three times in a game and it's a tough game for him individually and he's sad, and how he behaves is a tremendous value, tremendous asset you have as a parent. I'm evaluating my son, not on the physicality. I'm evaluating my son, how he behaves. Am I bringing up this child correctly? And boy, let me tell you, if your little trooper can come home and say, you know what, he's sad, he might cry, but you know what, chin up, let's you and I work it out together, because the value of you as a dad or mom to take time with your child, helping him grow mentally, socially, even physically at times, that mental social aspect, let him grow and develop, overcoming adversity. And then when little Johnny gets a hit next game or puts the ball in play and gets on first base, the world's great. And you know what? He had some success. People today are – go ahead. Sorry.
So part of what you're saying is that incredible – I mean, part of what sports teaches is that it's how you deal with failure, how you deal with success in a way, and also how to deal with motivation, your own motivation.
How to deal – the biggest thing about youth sports that I believe that we're missing is how to be a good teammate.
Oh.
How to be a good teammate. And I go back to Alan Williams, teammates matter. That comes from the highest skilled to the lowest skilled. We are teammates. How we treat each other on a skill level basis is so important, because if I'm the best athlete and you're not very good, do I help you become better? Isn't that part of my job? And I say this because raising two daughters, and as they went through this a basketball situation, they would come home and say, oh, this girl here, this girl here, this girl here. I said, you know what your job is to do? Your job is to make those girls raise their game up. You should be working with them, not the coach. It's not their fault. You're very blessed. My children were very blessed and were very grateful. But your job is to raise them up if you're going to be a good teammate. It has nothing to do with winning. It's about being a quality person and understanding, okay, this person might be a little short this athletic trait, but so what? My job is to help them raise themselves up, being confident in their ability, being confident in them as a person, and they can walk away feeling very proud. And it makes everybody, it makes the teammates, it makes the team concept so much valuable. So it's being a good teammate today. We forget about being a good teammate. All we want to do today is with this. It's not just not baseball. It's athletic in general. We have A teams. We have fathers, mothers, families spending college tuition. I just read a tweet yesterday. 58% of people spend $5,000 or less on last year's high school. Last year's baseball player at probably at a middle school, high school level to go travel. 38%, something like that, spent over $5,000, anywhere from $5,000 to $10,000. Well, I might be old fashioned and I might be out of the loop, but all I know is this. If I'm a mom and dad and I do not know how to teach my child to hit, I do not know much about baseball. It could be basketball. It could be soccer. It could be the piano. It's my responsibility not to send them off to someone who is going to teach them. It's my job to be with them, to educate them, to listen. And my job is to spend time with them so at least the dialogue continues. I take a genuine interest in my child's ability and their what they really love to do. And therefore, I'm going to try to carry this as long as I can, because as you and I both talked, the ultimate goal in all of this is at the end of the day, when they walk through the high school doors or they go through college and they end up playing, we're hoping that they pick up the phone each and every day and they call you. That's the ultimate goal. It's not about scholarships. It's not about chasing the dream. It's about that. The other things come into play. So for me, youth sports and how we go about it, it's a 17 youth sports, and if I got this stat right, a $17 billion industry in 2017.
For baseball or for all sports?
You better answer that.
I'll let it go. It'll go into answering.
Okay. So $17 billion worth of sports, sport industry.
Is that professional sports or all professional and?
All your sports, $17 billion. And I just read that this morning, and that's based on this article I saw. And it's as big as the NFL. That's equal to the NFL, their industry. Anyway, so we're spending all this money on equipment and travel, and it's unbelievable how much more money we're spending. But I guess the ultimate goal for me is, what are we spending it? Why are we spending so much money? It's okay. I have to buy a bat, skates, whatever it is. I get all that. But what are we going, what's the goal? Isn't the goal is to have the dialogue and have the time to spend with your child, as opposed to I'm running him to a game, I'll sit there and the coach is going to handle him for the rest of the time. And then after it's done, I don't really have an understanding of what really is going on or how my child is getting better. And again, we're chasing this scholarship, we're chasing this dream. Or here's another thing that is bothersome too as well. So what we do is we have all these select teams, soccer, whatever, hockey, which you're familiar with.
Yeah.
But we're also selecting other community people. Some of these things are so big, we're selecting all these best players from all this our surrounding area to go participate. So, and I just read this again, and it just makes so much sense. We're sucking the best talent out of all these communities. So where does it leave the other kids? Where does that leave this other community? Does it dry up? I have no interest. I don't care to play anymore. I guess I'm not one of the best ones. And I get so upset when our current parent structure are so blinded to the fact that relationships, friendships. If we're good enough, somebody will notice us. It's with social media, with everything else around here, how can you not get noticed today if you have a skill set in anything? We don't need to travel ultimate and spend all this money. The best gift you can give your child is to sit there and talk to them about, okay, let's go work on this. It can be shooting hoops in the backyard. It can go ahead and throwing balls off your garage door, whatever it is. But you're there with them, spending time and teaching, and you're teaching them a little bit, but at the same time, it's relationships, because I want a relationship with my children after it's all said and done. And that's the goal that nobody talks about. And that's my passion. My passion is talk to your children. There's a place and a time to be competitive. There is a place and time. There is a place and time to go show your skills somewhere. But please, it's not before you're 14, 15 years old. I mean, I just don't understand why we need to do that, because it's okay. If you want to take Johnny to a game and he wants to go on this travel team at the right time, that's fine. There is a place for that in our society, but not when they're in elementary school, please. Not, and that's what really hurts me, because we try to just to be very selective in our society, and we're doing the wrong thing. We're not doing kids a very good justice of giving them opportunities to find out about themselves. And that's what really sports and athletics does for a family. But a child, find out about yourself.
You know, if you check out, you're not going to come back, because, right?
Yep. It's extremely, especially today. Especially today, I mean, we're making decisions so early. Why is it, we like in our league, we don't keep the scoreboard on. I mean, a lot of times we just don't have the scoreboard on because it's healthier. I just read this fantastic article, and I just happened to catch it on Twitter this morning, and it just hit everything. The city of Norway, or the country of Norway, has got it figured out. With their youth sports, they decided, I think their youth hockey, they decided no longer to have a championship.
Oh, really?
Pardon?
Really? Why?
In hockey, they no longer decided to have championships at youth level, because what ends up happening is that, just like we talked about, they start going after all the best players in areas and sucking up the best players, where the other secondary players are left hanging. And there, we don't have a league here. We don't get the chance to play because our best players are gone. And again, it's okay to play with everyone. That's why when we have our small schools, our own elementary, they have the parents like it, and the parents like each other, and we all try to get along. And at the end of the day, realistically, at the end of the day, Lois, in our league, after the game is done, everybody's up to the concession stand and getting a hot dog and Coke anyway, or laughing about it because it's over. It's not so competitive where we lose the focus of what's really important. I had this one little boy. I'll never forget it. I have this one little boy, and I was umpiring a game, and he was 11 years old. And this batter stepped up to the plate, and I was right behind the pitcher. And he turned around to all the fielders. He goes, "Back up, guys. This guy can really hit." I thought, okay. So this little boy goes into his windup, and he delivers the pitch. And the kid hits a missile out to the fence. And the outfielders are chasing after it. And they throw it back to him, and they throw it back to the pitcher. And the pitcher gets the ball, and he goes, "See, I told you, he can really hit." What a wonderful outlook about life, about being a little boy. You know, it just touches my heart, because he was in it for the right reason. He wanted to be on the mound, he wanted to pitch, and he knew this little boy was really good, and he wasn't mad. He was going, okay, I'm gonna try to get this guy out. What a wonderful scenario. Just, I was so happy I was there, because a lot of times I don't get a chance to be there all the time, but just a wonderful way of going about it. And that's what youth sports is all about. Watching little boys and little girls just develop themselves and learning how to handle many situations, you know, many life situations, good, bad, adversity. And I know I'm rambling here, but I probably will get emotional on this one. But when my little boy was a freshman,
In high school,
uh-huh. it's Dalton, he made an out, and he threw his helmet, flipped his helmet. He never flipped his helmet before. So I'm back in the stands, and I watch it. So we get done with the game, and then we get in the car. And it's the ride. And another thing, Lois, that ride home, when kids are not able to drive yet, that ride home is a very important time. It's really good. You can watch all the behavior you want out of your child. Your emotions come out. So I asked him, I said, "Why did you throw your helmet? I don't understand that." He goes, "Well, the other guy did it. He was a junior and a really good player." And I said, I said, so whatever he does is good enough. I said, I'm going to tell you this right now. If you throw your helmet again, it disgusts me. I said, it tells me everything you want about, I don't want you. I know if I'm a college guy and I'm looking at you, or you keep your emotions under control. It's okay to be mad. It's okay to be upset. You really need to keep your emotions under control. So he listened. He's always been a really good listener. So the next game comes out. There he is right there. So the next game comes up, and he ended up, there were two outs, runner on bases, and he grounded out to the second baseman. Last out. And he hustled down the line, and he was out, and he turned around, and the game was over. Get done with the game, get the car, come on home. So as we're leaving our little town of Marshfield, I tell him, I said, you know, I'm really proud of you. No, nothing. I said, do you know why? He goes, yeah. I made the last out, I was really mad, and I didn't throw my helmet, and I kept myself under control. And I told him, you got it, buddy. You get it. You get the big picture because you're going to get another chance. It's okay. He gets it. And to this day, he's so emotionally stable, good and bad. You know, he doesn't get too high, doesn't get too low. And again, it's okay to be upset. Just if you want to be upset in the car, let me have it. But when it comes to when you're in a public arena, it's okay. You need to handle yourself correctly. And you will when things come up in life, you'll handle it better. So, I mean, those are all experiences as a parent and that I've gone through with him and my girls and in our league. It's been challenging to try to – I mean, I want to really quit this league 3 or 4 years ago because I was so tired of the youth parents trying to manipulate the way – they wanted the league to run as opposed to understanding a bigger picture of, hey, watch your little boy, watch your little girl, enjoy them, enjoy all of them, no matter who you're playing, because this is our community. Watch them all and encourage them all. And then hopefully your child, the behavior of your child, is something you can be very proud of. Because you get exposed when you're on a field, you're on a court, you're playing tennis. Doesn't matter. You're exposed. If they can handle themselves through tough times, if you're a parent, applaud yourself on the back because that you've done a great job. But that message gets lost.
Well, it sure does, doesn't it?
Yes. Very much so.
You know what? We could do a whole book just on tips for parents, tips for youth sports, tips for, there's a lot here.
I know.
A lot here. And a tremendous amount. So I'm going to mush on that because I think we lay the groundwork, don't we, early on for what happens to the people that go into the workplace or into professional sports. And then we expect something different out of them.
That is correct. And, you know, my middle daughter, I think what ends up happening when you really do things well, when you get your kids and if they want to be involved in youth sports, and if you really understand the bigger picture, my little boy can't throw the ball like Johnny can, and that's okay, but you are going to play catch with him and you're going to teach him, and he gets out there and he does some things and he feels good about himself and he's confident, and with, you know, adversity in between a little bit, but the relationship you build and understanding, you know, where you're at, whatever skill level, gosh darn it, you know what, you're always going to have dialogue with your child. He will always come to you saying, I'm having trouble in school, hey, Dad, can you help me? I mean, it all part, it's just not about athletics. It's about the whole gamut of their whole day. It can be about a relationship with a boy or girl. It can be their schoolwork. Hey, you know, things like this. Hey, I lost my phone. You know, how am I handling it? What's my responsibility? But the constant dialogue, and I think that's what I really want to have. But if you do those things right, at the end of the day, at the end of the day, when they go off to, let's say, college or whatever, they go into the workforce and they're a blue-collar worker, you've teaching them values that they will be okay. They understand organization. They understand about structure. They understand about commitment and a work ethic, and I have to be on time and all those things that come into play. And even if they go to college, I know the college scene and all the things that they can get involved with, but if you really know that your core value things are really set in stone at home, with a communication being the number one priority, they're going to be calling you. They're not just going to shut you off for weeks and go, I don't even know how he's doing or she's doing. My daughter's going through the same thing. She's now the new varsity coach here. We have 1,200 kids in our school. 1,200. 27 kids went off for basketball at the high school level. The reason why is because we have already decided when they have been third graders, fourth graders, fifth graders, sixth graders, here's the A team. So I'm a B teamer. Well, I'm not even picked for the team. We try out.
Right.
Lois, we try out as fourth and fifth graders, sixth graders. What are we doing? Tryouts.
Yeah, I know.
You know it, hockey. You know, you live it. We try out. So whatever happened to, you know what? And again, I know it's never going to happen. It's never going to go back. But what happens about going, you know what? How about getting a bunch of kids together and go play hockey? Go do this. Go skate. Do it. Just go play. You can't even go to a playground anymore without getting a permit to go and play. Play. Everything's locked.
Somebody has the space.
Yes. I mean, it's just our own society has created this dilemma. But we can still get around this by at least saying, you know what? I choose not to do this. I choose to do something different. I choose as a parent to go ahead and say, you know what? I'm going to be involved in this program, and I'm going to have my kids just participate. Because we're not after a college scholarship. And honestly, Lois, do I really want to run around the country and chase, and you know, he's going here and he's going there and chase around the country where I could really, I mean, for God's sakes, you're in Minnesota. There's got to be tons of hockey all around you.
Oh, yes.
I mean, so is there any place where we can just go play and just have a
no, because you have to get rink time.
Right.
You cannot. You have to get rink time. Yeah. And 8 and 9 year olds are playing hockey at 10 p.m. when they should be in bed.
No question. Same as goes on here. What are we thinking? What are we doing? Because everybody else gets the priority. We've got to have that varsity. You got to have the older kids, and they got to do it. No question. We're so messed up. And if it is 10 o'clock, you know what? I know my little boy wants to do that, but is there a different program where I can just get him on the ice? And I go back to Rich Donnelly. So, I mean, again, I was privileged that Dalton traveled. All my kids traveled with me at times, but Dalton was like 9 or 10, and he played. He came with me and traveled with me on a couple of trips. And we'd be out at the ballpark, and I would hit him pop-ups, and he would hit in the cage. And I asked Rich, because Rich is a father of – God, I don't even know how many kids. I said, Rich, you think I'm doing the right thing? He goes, he's with you, isn't he? I said, yeah. He goes, you're doing the right thing. He's with you. And he when he said that to me, it's like, you're right. He's with me. Him and I together is more valuable than him playing on a tournament team. And it was just absolutely right on. And why would I want to occupy all my summer? And even when he did go play a couple tournaments, we didn't occupy our whole summer. We were a family. We decided that family is more important than the chase. We need to be together. Anyway, that's my story.
You know what? That's incredible. And what I'm going to do is we'll start with the what's our end goal with sports and then tell the stories with it so people get the context of what we're talking about. And then you, we can go from there. Now, I'm going to highlight these, and it is rich. It is very rich and wonderful. So we've been talking about 47 minutes, and so it'll be, we'll organize it. So it flows, and I don't mind if it's 40, 45 minutes, because I mean, I think it's huge. I think it's huge.
Okay.
So then I want to go on to, what are the highlights from that you want to talk about from Leland? And I also want the highlights from your career. What did you learn? What did professional sports and being in that baseball life teach you? Okay. You know, because everybody, I shouldn't say everybody, but I think we romanticize about movie stars, about athletes, about, you know, anybody who is in the limelight, so to speak, and professional sports is part of that, right?
Correct.
And but what was that for you? What did you learn from that?
Well, believe it or not, when I was a little boy, I grew up in the country, first of all, then I moved to our city of Marshfield, but we grew up next to a ball diamond in Roselleville, Wisconsin. And obviously, being in central Wisconsin again, the only thing that I would do is when the grass didn't turn so muddy, we would spend time at the ballpark. And so we were up there in a country setting with no organization, no nothing, just whoever showed up, and it could have been my brother and I. We'll find a way to play 500. We'll find a way to throw ground balls. We just played. And I came up with it was probably my brother and my sister, because we were kind of the three that were a little bit older. So, but whoever was in the neighborhood, we came and played. So we just would play all summer, get our gloves, and just spend all day up there. Well, eventually we moved into our town of Marshfield when I was a fourth grader, and I joined Little League, the same Little League that I try to reinvent now. And, you know, I played and really enjoyed it. It was only during the summer. It was just local. There was no travel. So as time went on, I had a skill set. I'll never forget, though, my baseball coach, who was my guidance counselor, asked me, what do you want to do when you leave the school? I said, I want to go play baseball. Yeah, and I was all, and you got to understand, I was like 5'2". That was a little shit.
In high school?
Oh, my God, I was small. I was really? So small. 5'2", 5'4". I graduated probably at 5'6", 5'7". My wife and I were damn near the same height all the way through high school. So he goes, well, that's all well and good, Gary, but you know, what do you want to do? I said, I'm going to play Major League Baseball. And he asked me the third time, and I said the same thing. And he goes, well, what about being a fireman or something? I said, no, this is what I'm going to do. So the story keeps going where I ended up being a nice high school player, and I didn't have anybody recruit me except at UW Oshkosh, which is a Division III school. And they only found out about me through another player, and I basically walked on campus and played for a very instrumental father figure in Dr. Russ Tiedemann, who was fair, tough, and loving at the same time. I started as a freshman. But I always thought that I was going to be a professional baseball player. I mean, but he taught me a lot of toughness. I was tough anyway, but he was really tough on me. He was really hard on me in a good way. I took it. I could take it. That's okay. And I was going to outwork everybody. I mean, running sprints, doing drill work. There's nobody. I knew what I wanted to do, but I never won anything until I went to Oshkosh and I found out more about a team concept than anything, because he recruited well. And he was absolutely fabulous in helping me get to the next level. So, long story short, Had a wonderful 3 years. Went to the College World Series all three times. Came up short, but was there. Ended up getting drafted by the Chicago Cubs in the fifth round in 1982. So, as I started my career, I was extremely homesick. I had never left home. I mean, college, I was leaving home, but I was an hour and a half away. Finally, here I go, and I'm on the bus, and it's like, okay, so it was homesick for first couple weeks, but then it was playing every day and getting into the routine. And so I just played. I didn't know any technique. I didn't know any – I was a second baseman. I didn't know much about how the professional game is sort of played. I watched it all the time and listened to it all the time. But so he started playing and doing well. I could run. And then we had a hitting instructor basically tell me that, well, you need to hit this way because this is the way it's really going to help you. And I thought to myself, well, I guess you would know because you're a professional instructor, not a college instructor, not a high school instructor. So I was forced to kind of do these drill packages and totally screwed me up. Couldn't do the things I was good at anymore. And I scuffled. I just didn't know how. I mean, I could still survive because of a skill set, quick hands. I could still run and I'd have my moments, but it was not that very consistent and striking out a lot. And why am I doing that? Anyway, I kept plugging away and kept, you know, in the off season when I would come home, I would work on my hitting, but really I didn't really have an understanding of what I was doing. I thought this is the way I'm going to hit this year, whether it's my stance or my hands and all that. My brother would throw to me, and it was a constant work in progress. So I kept plugging away, and I finally got to Double A baseball, which was in Midland, Texas, and then we transferred to Pittsfield, Massachusetts. I spent 3 years in Double A trying to figure myself out a little bit. And ironically, I changed positions in the outfield, which probably helped me. I had one guy. I was getting released in 1984, and our pitching coach saved me, Dick Pohl. He saved my career. They were going to release me to the Cubs, and Dick Pohl says, I will take him in a meeting prior to everybody leaving for their schedule or for their season. I will take him, and he'll be my third catcher. And what Dick did was
what team was he with?
He was with us, and that he was going to be our pitching coach in Pittsfield, Massachusetts, the Pittsfield Cubs. And basically what he did was he taught me how to throw from the outfield. He would hit me tons of ground balls way before everybody got there. We'd go at third base, and he'd hit me ground balls, and I'd throw it across the infield, learning how to use my arm correctly. But I also had a couple teammates that would help me hit and teach me a little bit more. And I found myself and started getting myself going. And I put myself on the map. Ironically, my third year in Double A, I was doing so well that the Cubs were actually going to call me up in August. And I ended up injuring my foot, and I never got that call, and ended up, you know, waiting. You know, I didn't get called up that year. That was 86. So in 87, I ended up going to AAA and had a phenomenal year. I was with Dick Pohl again, our pitching coach, and he was instrumental. And he was just very instrumental in my makeup and my mental capacity handling certain things. But AAA baseball at that time was very tough. There was a lot of good players that couldn't break into the big leagues. And so AAA was a very good barometer of could you play in the big leagues. So played there a whole year, had a great year, never got called up. The following year, went back to AAA and finally got called up on June 3rd to Chicago. So after 6.5 years of persevering in the minor leagues and going through a lot of tough times, but good training times, I got to the big leagues and basically stayed the rest of the year. So perseverance, grinding it out, work ethic, trying to figure out who I am, what do I do well, not listening to a whole lot of people, finally got myself there. And started off in 1989. I didn't get off to a good start, kind of struggled a little bit. And the Cubs wanted me to be this pinch hitter off the bench, where instead of using all the fields and working the ball to left field, which I was, that was who I am. If I hit the ball the opposite way and up the middle, I always give myself a chance. Pulling the ball was not a, I mean, I could pull the ball, but it doesn't parlay into my speed and getting on. So pull the ball, learn how to pull the ball better, get the ball in the air. Cause as you come up in the pinch hit, if you can hit a home run and, you know, pull the ball, you'll help us win. So obviously trying to stay in the major league level, I did it. And I kept practicing it, but unfortunately it wasn't my strength, but that's what they wanted me to do. So I did it. And I found myself 3.5 weeks later back in AAA because again, I was so mentally screwed up. That wasn't who I was. It wasn't my strength. So back down to AAA, worked on getting myself back into who I was. In the off season, I actually went to a hitting camp. It was the Wade Boggs hitting camp. It doesn't matter. But anyway, met some good people, got myself relocated a little bit, got myself aligned a little bit, went through 90, got a little bit of time in Chicago. But then I got traded to Pittsburgh in the 1991 season. And I got traded at the end of spring training. And so the Cubs had treated me very well. Don't get me wrong. It was a wonderful experience. Wrigley Field, by far, was playing there in Chicago. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was there for the night game. I mean, it was just great. It's just a different electric atmosphere. It's very privileged to wear a Cubs uniform. And we won in 89. We just didn't beat the Giants to go to the World Series. But I got traded to Pittsburgh, and I met Jim Leland. And Jim Leland, I'll tell you from the get, he is the best person I've ever met and the greatest leader I think I'll ever be around. And a lot of people can probably say the same thing. He knows how to touch people. He knows how to get the best. He sees the glass half full instead of half empty. Long story short, now Jim loves to have fun, and Jim loves to kid with you in a good way and sarcastic way sometimes, but you got to learn how to read it. So obviously I had a lot of questions. So as I get traded over there and a couple of days go by, I asked him a couple of questions. I said, Jim, how do you want me to hit? And again, you have to excuse my language, but it's the only way to get across exactly how Jim Leland is. And Jim Leland looked at me. Now here's a guy who played no higher than Double-A baseball. Hit 222 as a lifetime catcher with one home run. So he doesn't know anything about hitting. But he looks at me and goes, well, Jesus fucking Christ. He goes, I don't give a shit if you go up to the bat, if you go up to the plate with your bat up your ass, just get the hell on first base and I'll take care of the rest. And I just was stymied. He just kind of froze me. And what he was trying to tell me is this.
Be yourself.
Be who you are. It's too hard to be someone else. Whatever you do, do it well. So if you need to bunt, bunt. If you can hit the ball the other way, fine. Do what you do. Because I don't know enough about hitting, number one. And second of all, it's too hard to teach hitting. As far as I can't teach it. So whatever you do, just get the hell on first base and I'll take care of the rest. And so what it did is just relieve me of trying to be someone else. And the thing is, what he does so well, he's the master. At he knew doggone well that I could hit a fastball. Didn't matter how fast it was, I could hit a fastball. And he always tried to match me up whenever I hit. I wasn't an everyday player. But he always tried to match me up against guys who threw hard. So therefore, it parlayed into my strength, not my weakness. If a guy threw a lot of change-ups and he was a spitballer and he could, it wasn't a strength of mine. The strength of mine was to be able to hit very hard fastballs because that was my strength. So he made sure that over the course of time, not every time, but the course of time, I was matched up against somebody who would parlay to my strength. And I had the greatest year of my life. I had the greatest baseball season of my life. And I hit home runs by accident. I hit 4 home runs that year by accident. One more for pinch hitting. So he understood, and I wasn't the only guy. We had bullpen guys. When you talk about trying to navigate through a season, you've got your superstars. We had Barry Bonds. We had Bobby Bonilla. We had Andy Van Slyke. And you know what? There's some high egos there, and he did a great job of managing those egos to make sure that the team stayed focused, centered, where we're going, how we're going to go about it. And he had to match up those egos to make sure that they stayed on focus. It's the guys like me and the guys who are on the bench and the guys that are in the bullpen matching those pieces up so they can help us as a team. I'm going to match them up so they have success on the mound or at the plate. And knowing that the greatest asset he has on top of that, I keep going better, this guy here knows that when things don't go well, the last thing I need to do is not talk to him. He is the master. He is the master at when things are going poorly, he's there talking to you the next day. So that's one of his greatest skills is his communication and keeping things simple, but continue to talk to you, especially when things aren't going well. This guy could run a hospital. He could run a car dealership. He could run anything because it's all about the people wanting to work, wanting to make Jim, because he gets the person. He wants, you want to play for him. You want him to get better. You want to do it for Jim because Jim cares about you. And that's the greatest asset he brings to – I keep going greatest asset. That's another asset he brings to building a team. He knows the strengths. He knows what you do well. He knows what this person does well. He knows what this person does well. It's not what he doesn't do well, what he does well. So by playing for Jim for 2 years and we won the division, we were in the National League Championship twice – playing for Jim opened up a whole different way of how myself, because eventually I wanted to stay in the game and how to manage a team, how to manage people, how to talk to people, how to get the best out of them. I mean, Jim never went to psychology school, but Jim got certain guys needed the pat on the back, a little chewing out, be able to kid with, but he always was able to hit everybody to keep them up. And I mean, when you're playing every game, every day, and trying to make sure 25 guys are pulling at the same end of the rope, that's a challenge. He could do it. He was the best at doing it. And he did so many wonderful things. Now, I know we're getting off tangent about Leland, but I'll come back to what baseball did for me. So then, as life goes on here, I play for Cincinnati for a year. Very disheartened, even though I played with some great players and some great friendships I made there. Was a tough time. Mark Schott got suspended for her racial comments. And then we had a very poor GM, didn't really know how to handle people very well. We had some altercations in the clubhouse. Went back to Pittsburgh the following year. We didn't do as well, but playing for Jim was just well worth being a whole nother year with him. And then I finished with the Phillies. That was my last year in 1995, played for Jim Fregosi, another wonderful guy, had a great time in Philly. And then I tried to play with the Yankees and Mets in spring training and got released twice. And I came home and I said, that was it. I'm not going to do this anymore. And Dalton was going to be born in that July. So what did I learn from my baseball career? There were so many players that were so much better than I was athletically and skills. And sometimes I look back and I'm going, how the heck did I make it? How did I get almost 7 years of major league service as a player? I'll tell you what, the grinding mentality, the outworking everybody, having a little better understanding of, once I figured out who I was and what I could do, it was a matter of somebody matching my skill set to where I could help. I think just the understanding the perseverance that comes from wanting to attain a goal, especially when we go back to as a 5'2" sophomore telling your guidance counselor you're going to play Major League Baseball. I just didn't think dreaming big was not that big. I think dreaming big was okay. Mm-hmm. And what's wrong with that? I get the odds, but I didn't care. This is what I wanted to do. So.
Super.
Hold on a minute. Come on, Frank. Come on, go outside. Hold on, Rose. Okay, I had to let my dog out.
No problem.
Okay.
What kind of dog do you have?
Hungarian Vizslas.
I don't know what a Hungarian Vizslas is.
They are, you know what a Weimaraner is?
Yes.
Okay.
Big dogs.
They're a smaller, much smaller version of that.
Okay.
They're rust colored. Yeah, we've always had them, and we've got two of them, Frank and Stella. And so anyway, they are, that's where I was all morning. I usually take them for a walk in the morning, or Kay does. And so they're high maintenance. They like to run. So we've got a full backyard. So it's like they can go, but I usually take them out and run them for at least an hour, hour and a half, and get my walking in anyway.
Good for you. Yeah. Good for you. It keeps you healthy.
You bet.
Wow. You know what? There are so many things here. And I think I'm going to just let you tell that story. And I love, I think this is, when you take a look at all of the research that's being done right now on what is it that's allowing corporations to work, what allows employees to be engaged at work. Think of this. Right now, statistics say that 80%, 81% actually, of employees are overwhelmed and stressed. When part of that, 21% of companies say that actually they're so overwhelmed and stressed that it's hit critical levels within their organization. Think of it. Yeah. That's huge, right?
Yes.
And so we are also finding from Gallup's research that only 3 out of every 10 people care about showing up for work every day. That means 7 out of 10 don't want to be there.
Yes.
That's amazing. So, and part of it is because people don't feel like they're being used the way they could be used, but they don't know who they are.
Correct.
You know, and it goes back to all of what you said earlier about sports as kids, but they've grown up in this environment. They don't know who they are. And so they're showing up hoping to be noticed, to fit in somehow, and it's not working.
No. And you're the whole point, I mean, it's interesting you say that because Kay works at the hospital. She's one of those 7 out of 10. She loves her. And again, I know we're old school, but she's so interested in patient care. She's in cardiac rehab.
Okay. She's a nurse?
She's a nurse.
Uh-huh.
Absolutely loves when she can touch a patient and get them motivated to get up on their feet after their TAVR, after their open heart surgery, and get them going. The greatest reward she has each day is, I saw 5 patients, but I got this guy who didn't want to get up, and he got on his feet and he walked 20 yards for me. You hear her stories and you hear her eyes sparkle. You see her passion, but the problem is her passion is only her passion. The rest of the staff that she works for don't get it, and they don't care. They don't care about what she does. And I know she spends probably a little bit more time in today's society about patient care. All I know is that those patients are educated. It's heartwarming. The siblings and the wife understands, or whoever doesn't have the heart surgery, but they care. and they have a great understanding, but she's one of the, she's a 7 out of 10. She comes home and she goes, I'm so pissed off because all the administrative part sucks.
Right.
And so, and she's not a millennial. I get that, but you're right. In today's society, I mean, the stress levels and what we're trying to bring, but if you've got a leader that can get,
pull that out.
What is it you do well? If I can find out what you do well, what motivates you, and I'm going to put you in situations where you can be successful and you're going to enjoy coming. Oh my God, to enjoy coming, to go teach, to go nurse, to do sell cars, to sell insurance, whatever it is. If you got that passion, you're going to have a great day. You will always have a great day when you get home. Your stress level should be much healthier and much better. And you're able to recharge for the next day.
Yep, you're absolutely right.
You know, I don't know if I'm right, but I just know that going to work for Jim Leland
was passion.
Oh my God, I couldn't wait to get to the ballpark. Even when I had a bad day, I couldn't wait. It was just because I wanted to help our team win. I wanted to help him. He believed in me. When he believed in me, not that Don Zimmer didn't believe in me, not that Jim Fregosi didn't believe in me, but Jim Leland, when he believed in me, and he's kept talking to me when things were going poor, oh my God, it opened up a whole new level of confidence. I am confident in my ability. I know again, baseball versus being a doctor, nurse, whatever, is a little different, but I have passion for what I'm doing. And when I have passion, you know what? At the end of the day, every 2 weeks, I know I'm going to get a check, but it's almost like a bonus because I'm enjoying what I'm doing.
Yeah. And actually, it's not a whole lot different than what happens in hospitals or any place either. Because, you know, when I think of the very first job that I had with cancer patients or head of OBG for the University of Minnesota, and on cancer, gynae cancer, our mortality rate was 80%. Yeah. Nobody wanted to be there, right? I told you that story.
Yes.
And you change. But we did the same thing as what Leland did. We let people choose what they were good at, and that's what they did. And we negotiated that. Everybody negotiated, and what was left over had to be done, right? So you negotiated that also. But the difference in outcomes was unbelievable. Unbelievable. So
it's the same thing. It really is. And if you look at Jim Leland's history of where he's gone, he's always been a winner. Why? Because of his staff and their communication. And yeah, he had great players. I understand that. But he also came from nothing. He took over Pittsburgh when there was nothing, and he built a winner into it. But the people he touched, and now after it's all said and done, now what do we do after the Pittsburgh and Jim Leland? Well, we got a lot of guys doing a lot of different things, and they're successful in life, not just baseball.
Got it. So tell me, after you left professional sports, what have you done?
I never left.
You never left because you went back to coaching. That's right. Okay. Right.
So I started managing. So I worked for the Seattle Mariners for 2 years, and I was up in Appleton, Wisconsin as a manager. And that was my first taste of being a manager on the other side, not playing. Then I joined the Phillies, and I went to Double A, Reading, Pennsylvania. Great, great 3 years there. Really learned a lot. I really learned a lot about how to work with staff that works there at the ballpark. Never had to really do that before, whether it's PR, media relations. They're trying to make money. So it was really good. Had a great guy. And Chuck Domino was just outstanding. He was our general manager, so he was really fun to work with. And then I was the bench coach for the Phillies for 5 years. So I worked with Larry Bow and Charlie Manuel. So I was there for 5 years. Got fired. got fired. Hooked on with the Cleveland Indians for 1 year. Back to the minor leagues as a roving outfield instructor. Had an absolute ball with a bunch of great people, and I never should have left. But I got a job with the Pirates to be their bench coach, and so I took the job, and it was a struggle trying to rebuild the Pirates. And I was okay with the rebuild, but I did not work for a very good manager. Horrible communication. I got frustrated. Basically, I got myself fired because I let him have it. I was fed up with the mentality with him. So I got fired, came home, spent a whole year with my family and found a whole different lifestyle. I was home for an entire year, and I thought to myself, this isn't so bad. Even though I do miss baseball, I got to spend time with all my kids. And never did that before. And really, really enjoyed it. I hooked on with the Angels for 5 years. I became a scout. And I scouted there for 5 years. Learned the scouting part of it. The people that hired me left after 5 years. And that's when I rejoined the Pirates. And this is my second year with them. And ironically, the same people who fired me hired me back. So I guess it tells me a little something about me. I'm not such an asshole anyway. I'm pretty good. I'm an okay guy. So, but I learned a lot, and they're good. They're good for me. And this job is really healthy for me. It gives me a whole different dimension about really what baseball is. A lot of times when you're in uniform, you're competing. You're teaching, but you're competing. You're playing every night. So you're competing in the game. For scouting, I'm not competing. What I'm doing is evaluating. And my evaluation skills, I hope, are good enough where maybe I can out-compete with this other scout that's next to me that's seen this other guy because of my experiences. And again, I don't think I'm the greatest scout in the world, but it's a work in progress, and I'm learning a lot. And I think I have a pretty good idea of what we can do. And this is a guy that I'm interested in. This is a guy that I'm not interested in. So it's really helped me open up my diversification of baseball, where I could help, where I can be better, where I can help the Pirates. But yet, it gives me great balance to be home. Since I played and since I've been in coaching, you're gone February 14th and you're not home until October. And it's time in my life to do something else where I can enjoy home. I can enjoy my wife. I can enjoy family. I can do things to make life easier for all of us. So I'm very fortunate. I mean, from a financial situation, I'm very fortunate because I've got a full pension. So, I mean, that's the one thing I have. If I didn't have it, it'd be a little different, but I have it, so I'm okay. I can make choices now.
Good for you.
Yeah, thank you.
Good for you. So now we'll get your stories out because I think they're incredible. They're priceless. Let's take a look at the top 3 to 5 things that you learned from Leland.
Okay. Hold on. Boy, I tell you one thing. If you ever get a chance to talk to Rich Donnelly, oh my God, you'll run out of tape and you'll be laughing your butt off. Okay.
Looking forward to it. So thank you for making that connection possibly.
Okay. So I will give you, I've got 4 of them offhand here.
Okay.
Ready? I made sure I wrote them down because somebody told me, at least write them down, write out. So anyway, so you already got one about the hitting.
About the hitting. Okay. Yes.
Okay. So here's the second one.
And I don't mind if that story repeats from one. Yeah. Okay. Go on.
All right. So, and I'm going to move around here. So it doesn't matter. Here's the story, how it happened. So in 1992, I'm not doing so well in the month of August, and we're going to win the division. We got a chance to go to the National League Championship Series and potentially the World Series. So I'm not doing so well. So I see that this guy got released from, I think it was from Cincinnati. His name was Todd Benzinger. Todd Benzinger was a switch hitting first baseman. Pretty good hitter. And I wanted to win. So I'm just trying to find myself. And I'm in one of those situations where things aren't going too well. And so anyway, I go into Leland and I say, look, I got something to ask you. He goes, well, what's on your mind? And I said, well, Todd Benzinger is out there and he's available for us. And I'm not doing real well at the time. Jim and I had this kind of relationship where I could be very honest with him. I wasn't trying to disguise anything. I said, Todd Benzinger's out there, and he might be able to help us win. What do you think? Now, again, you can only appreciate this because this is how Jim Leland talks, and I can't tell it any other way. He goes, sit the fuck down, and I'm going to fucking tell you something right now. He goes, the last thing this fucking – and he starts bobbing his head. This last thing this fucking team needs is Todd fucking Benzinger, and I'm going to tell you why. He goes, he's going to come in here, and he thinks he's going to be a starter. He thinks he's going to take away somebody else's job, and he's going to create all kinds of fucking problems for me on this team. He goes, he will not be on this team. You will be on this team. Your job is to continue to persevere and get better and get out there and do the best you fucking can, because the last thing I need to do is have a fucking pain in the ass on the bench. Do you fucking understand me? And I said, okay, I got it. He goes, now get the fuck out of here and go out there and keep working. Unbelievable. I walked out and went, oh my God. So again, a lesson learned. Lesson learned in the big picture is, you bring in somebody from somebody else, is he going to be more of a, even though he might be skilled, is he more of a pain in the ass than what it's worth in the long run? I just saw this guy sent out this tweet. I'd rather take a two-star athlete and a five-star work ethic than a five-star athlete and a two-star work ethic. It's a great tweet. It was just wonderful. So anyway, that's the first one. So the next one would be, I hope you have to understand a little bit about the game. But so Rob Dibble was a closer for the Cincinnati Reds. Rob Dibble, hold on a minute. Come on. Okay, so Rob Dibble was a reliever, a closer for the Cincinnati Reds, and he threw hard. He probably ran it up there at that time, probably 100 miles an hour. I mean, he was all arms and legs, and he could really throw hard. But anyway, I went up there to pinch hit one night and struck out. Pretty big game, struck out, went back to the bench. So nothing was said. The next day, I'm in the outfield and I've got my work in. And one thing Jim always did was during batting practice, he would always work his way from the batting cage. He would go to left field, center field, right field. And what he would do is he would do all his touching. He would touch people. He would talk to people things are going well, things are not going well. And I was always the last guy always in right field. So I saw him coming out of the corner of my eye. And so I'm sitting there and I'm going, oh boy, here we go. And he comes up to the next six to me and he goes, Jesus fucking Christ. He goes, what kind of a fucking at bat was that last night? Oh, fucking Rob Dibble. Do you look like a monkey fucking a football out there? Jesus. He goes, this is a fucking big leagues. What the fuck were you doing? And of course I laughed like you did. And he goes, God damn it. This fucking shit ain't funny. This is a fucking big leagues, man. He goes, you got to fucking have a better at bat than that. I said, yeah, I know, Jim, I know. There's a pause. Finally, he turns to me and he goes, God damn it, he was going pretty fucking hard last night, wasn't he? And I said, yeah. He goes, now, fucking tonight, get ready. I need you tonight. Let's fucking go. And off he went. So, in retrospect, he understood the challenge of the at-bat. He was perfectly fine, but he always busted my balls all the time before he got to his point, always. So anyway, he made me feel good. You know what? You struck out. Move on. Let's go. I need you tonight, so let's go. So be ready for our team. Just who does that? I mean, who does it? Made me laugh. Made me giggle. I knew the at bat. I knew how big it was, and I just didn't. I didn't come through it. But it wasn't that easy, and he understood perfectly. Need you tonight. Let's go. Okay, so that's another one. Sorry about my language, but that's the only way I can tell the story. So here's another one. So anyway, if you're going to understand.
This is the whole book. Okay, go on. This will be a fun one. But yep.
So we made a trade for a guy named Alex Cole. And Alex Cole was a leadoff kind of a hitter, kind of could run a little bit. So one of the things that Jim always did was he was, when you were, had the steal sign, so if you were going to steal from first to second, it would never come from the third base coach. It would always come from the dugout. For example, there are many times that I had it, and I'll show you. So many times he goes, Varsh, you got the steal sign. I wasn't playing that day. You got the steal sign, so it's crossed arms. If you cross your arms and they look over, the guy's stealing. Sometimes it's crossed legs. So do you follow me so far?
Yep.
Okay. So we get Alex Cole. And so by God, he gets on the first game, and I've got the sign that day. He goes, Varsh, if you cross your legs, you know, that's the sign today. So it always changed from day to day. It could be crossed arms, crossed legs. He'd give it to other people, give it to the trainer. So I had it. So Alex Cole gets on first, and eventually he gets on the second. I never gave him the steal sign or nothing like that. He got over on his own. Two outs, nobody on. Two outs, and he's on second. And I thought to myself, well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to camouflage this. I'm going to cross my legs now because it doesn't really matter when you're on second base. It only matters when you're on first base. So I cross my legs. And next thing you know, shit, there he goes to third base. And as he's running, I'm dropping my leg down. I'm going, oh, my God. Now, Andy Van Slyke is a left-handed hitter. You never steal third with a left-handed hitter, and you never steal it with two outs. Andy Van Slyke is a great player. He has a chance to hit a two-run homer or drive you in. There goes Alex Cole. Shit. So Benito Santiago from the San Diego Padres has got a rifle arm. He catches it. I mean, Alex Cole is so dead out, it's not even funny. He throws the ball. And he throws it in the left field. And Alex Cole comes in to score. And I'm watching this. And so I'm watching Jim, and I'm going, oh, God. So Jim comes up, and he just shakes Alex's hand. Never says a word. And he must have flew out or something. The inning's over with. Rich Donnelly's at third base. So the inning's over. We go out to play defense. Here comes Rich. And Jim goes, Rich, come here. He goes, what in the fuck is going on out there? What in the fuck is Alex Cole doing? Did you fucking tell him to fucking steal? And he goes, Jim, I didn't tell him to steal. He goes, what in the fuck is going on? Jesus fucking Christ. He goes, Van Slyke's at the fucking plate, and this guy's fucking stealing third. And as he stops, he takes and he looks down at me because I'm only like three seats away from him. He looks at me, and I look at him. And he goes, Come here. So all three of us go down, and he goes, did you cross your legs? I said, yeah, I crossed my legs. I said, Jim, it only applies to guys at first base. He should know that. He goes, Jesus fucking Christ. He goes, do you fucking understand something? Players are fucking stupid. Players are fucking dumb. And you're trying to fucking out-trick this fucking guy. You're going to fucking cross his legs. A new guy that comes on this fucking team, and you're going to fucking out-trick him. Do you fucking understand? Because you're going to be managing someday. You're going to do this as well. Just keep it fucking simple, would you? Don't fucking be so fucking tricky. Do you understand? I go, you got it, Jim. I understand. And there's a pause. And then of course, classic Jim Leal. He goes, but we got that fucking run, didn't we? I said, we did. He's the master. So here's another one.
So what you learned from that was what?
Don't try to trick the players. You don't need to outthink it. Just keep things very simple. If you keep it simple, nothing will get screwed up. The more complicated you make it, because obviously the higher the stress situations, the more things can get screwed up. So just keep it simple.
Okay.
All right. So now, you know, Jim Leland's an avid chain smoker.
No.
He smokes all the time. Well, this is a classic for me. So we're in Dodger Stadium, and I'm on the bench and I see what the score is. The score is 2-2 and it's the seventh inning and Bob Walker's our starting pitcher. And we got a little bit of a rally going and I'm already ready. I've got my helmet. I've got my bat. I'm all set to go in case he needs me to pinch it for the pitcher. And so I'm sitting there and Jose Lean is our second baseman. He's up at the plate and there's two outs and a runner on second and Bob walks the next hitter. And chances are I might pinch it for him. So I'm ready and I've got things ready. And so anyway, Jose Lean ends up hitting a base hit through the middle, the run scores, and we're ahead 3-2. And Jim goes, Varsho! I mean, I jump out of my seat. He goes, come here. So I'm thinking, I put my helmet on and I got my bat. He goes, God damn it. He goes, run up to the clubhouse and give me another fucking pack of cigarettes. I just ran out. Did you got it, Jim? Ran up and got those Marlboros and came on back. He goes, okay, great. Now sit the hell down. I mean, classic. Who does that? And all of everybody on the bench laughed and all that kind of stuff. I mean, it was that type of relationship. I mean, I can't explain why he did it, but he kept Bob Walker. I knew why Bob Walker was going to be in the game because he didn't need me to pinch it right there. And I got it, but who calls your guy Varsho? And I put my helmet on. He goes, run up and give me another pack of cigarettes. I went, oh my God. Just that was him. That was our relationship. It was so damn comical at times, but he caught me.
You know, what's interesting about that is what he knew is he had a need. He had to take care of himself if he was going to leave the team, right? I mean, that's interesting.
I guess it was, I was confused at the time. I'm going, okay, whatever it takes, man, I'm a team player.
That's interesting. And a lot of people would have been angry instead of just saying, yeah. I'm a team player, right?
Oh my God. I was laughing. I was like, okay. And whatever. It was just one of those deals where it was really funny. Anyway.
One more.
Well, we were in Candlestick Park and seventh inning. And we're playing the Giants tie game. Barry Bonds comes up to the plate. Now I'm not playing. I'm sitting and I'm watching. And Barry Bonds comes to the plate and he hits a towering fly ball to right field. Now Candlestick Park, the weather's horrible. It was July. It's July-ish. It's horrible. It's cold. It's miserable. It's windy. And Barry pops up and Barry doesn't run it out. And Willie McGee drops the ball. And Barry's only on first base. He should have been on second, maybe third. And we're tied. So Barry's on first base, and I look down at Jim. Never reacts. Nothing. We end up playing out the inning. Barry ends up scoring. And we go ahead 3-2. And I'm going, oh, this ought to be good. This ought to be good. Shit. He comes over. Jim shakes his hand. Barry sits down. I went, you got to be kidding me. He should have got his ass chewed out. What do we do? I don't get it. So I didn't say a word. We ended up winning the game. I waited till the next day, and I said, hey, I've got to ask you. I said, why didn't you chew Barry's ass out? I mean, what the hell? And he goes, let me fucking explain something to you. If you ever get a chance to ever talk to Jim Leland, you're going to hear the same thing. Let me fucking explain something to you. He goes, what am I supposed to fucking do there? So he comes out, he comes in here. What am I going to do? You got the cameras all over me. You don't think Barry knew that he didn't screw up? You don't think Barry understood that he should have been on second and third? He knows it. I know it. We all know it. So it was embarrassing for him. So what do you want me to do? Make a big altercation about it and chew his ass out so everybody can see it? He goes, is that what you want me to do? I go, well, no. He goes, well, Jesus fucking Christ. He goes, I'll take care of it in my way, but I'm not going to do it there. I'll mention to him saying, you know, you got to run that ball up, but I'll do it in the outfield. I'm never going to embarrass him because you know what? He does post up every night. He's an everyday player. He's always prepared. Yeah, he's got an ego. It could be a pain in the ass, but you think I'm going to make a big fucking deal right there? Because the last thing I need to do is lose this fucking guy. I'll handle it the way I want to handle it. I said, okay, I understand. Now he goes, now, of course, now, Lois, this is typical Jim. And he goes, now, if that was you and you didn't run that ball out, your fucking ass would be in AAA. Always the shot. Always the shot. So, but it was a great teaching moment for me to watch. It was really wonderful. And it reminds me of another story where we were in Montreal. And Denny Nagel was our pitcher in 1992. He was pitching and he was getting his ass waxed. I mean, he was getting shelled all over the place. It was ugly. So, I gotta see who this is. Boy, he really didn't get a hold of me. So anyway, we were in Montreal. Denny Nagel's just getting his butt hammered. So anyway, Jim goes to the bullpen. He calls for a guy to come in to replace him. I've never, ever seen this happen in my life, and I still haven't seen this happen. He goes out to the mound, and he does not take the ball.
This is Leland goes out to the – Leland goes to the mound.
Hold on a minute. This is Dalton. Let me take this call.
Yeah, go ahead.
Hey, buddy. Hi. Okay.
Okay.
So Denny Nagel in Montreal, he's getting his ass waxed. He's just giving up all kinds of bombs and people are hitting him hard. So anyway, Jim goes to the bullpen and he calls for a reliever to come in. So Jim walks to the mound. Now Denny's there and a couple of infielders are there. Normally what ends up happening is that the manager asks for the ball, pitcher puts it in his hand and he walks off. So Jim gets out there but doesn't ask for the ball. Signals that the guy's coming in. This guy's coming running in from the bullpen. Denny hands the ball off to the other reliever. And Jim and Denny walk off the mound together. I watched this. And Terry Collins, who was a coach for us at that time, said, watch this. And he made me watch. Sure enough, they both walk off the mound together, and he makes Denny sit next to him for the remainder of the inning. I watched this, and I went, wow. He goes, you know why he did that? I said, I have an idea. Why don't you tell me? He goes, you know what? He just got humbled. He's a young player trying to find his way, and he doesn't really know if he belongs. He goes, you know what? He wanted to make sure that he was not going to walk off that mound by himself. He wasn't going to be alone. Jim's going to stand by him. And that was his way of saying, you're going to be okay. I believe in you. It's just one game. We're going to move on. Because normally what ends up happening is that the pitcher comes out, he goes to the end of the dugout, and he's all by himself and nobody talks to him. Jim made him feel part of that club, even though he was having a horrible day, and made him still stay part of this club and to be able to have confidence in him. It was incredible. The ironic part of it, the next day, we were shelling the Montreal guy. And Felipe Alou comes out and takes out the ball, and that pitcher was all by himself, went to the end of the dugout and sat there, and Terry goes, see what I mean?
Wow.
You're exactly right. You're exactly right. I see it. And I never forgot it. It was like, it was an incredible time where when things are going bad, Jim, you can count on me. I'm here for you. It was just incredible. You know, And he probably forgot all about it, but that's, he just does things like that that just connects so well with people. He's just, he's a phenomenal individual.
Wow.
There you go.
Thank you. So now I have a question for you. When do you have time for us to do this on into three segments that we can put up on the web in a finished form? You had the 14th available as a possibility. Is that a possibility? I'm in Idaho, but I could do it in the morning into your, we're 2 hours ahead there, or yeah, from us here. So my plane coming back, I'd have to leave the hotel at 2 o'clock our time.
Well, let's see. So in Idaho, it is what time there right now? Is it only an hour ahead or 2 hours ahead?
It's 2 hours. So okay. Right, so now it would be 11:40.
Okay. So if you started at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, your time, that would be 11 o'clock here.
Okay. Let's do it. Perfect. Which is better for you?
Well, why don't you go? Because time I get done with the dogs. How about 9 o'clock your time? Idaho time.
9 o'clock. 11 o'clock yours.
Yes, next Wednesday.
Next Wednesday. Perfect.
Okay.
Gary, you are absolutely wonderful. And then please keep in mind my offer, and we'll set up time and we'll really spend some time but we'll take a long day and just record.
Okay. That sounds fine.
A request. Pictures of you when as a baseball player. Do you have any that you could send me via email?
I'll do some digging. I mean, I have pictures, by of course. You don't want baseball cards, you want pictures.
Can I find you online? I should have looked.
Oh yeah, you can find me online. Yeah, but I've got some other pictures I'll send you. I'll take some shots of me. I'll just take some shots of me. I'll go through some scrapbooks. I don't have anything.
Yeah, just do it with your phone and send them.
Yeah, I will. I'll take some stuff and I'll find those out and I'll send them to you. In the meantime, I will, if you're okay, again, I'm going to call Rich Donnelly today or tomorrow.
I love it.
And I think having him share some of the same things that we are talking about, you will really enjoy Rich. Oh my God, he's so phenomenal human being. Been through a tough time. The Chicken Runs at Midnight is really about his cancerous daughter. And he lost his daughter. And he also just lost his son, Mikey. But that's, it's just an interesting parable of her life and what happened in the World Series. I'm going to tell you what, you can be really, if you put all the Leland stuff together, I mean, nobody's ever done this. The people have written about them, but I'm going to tell you what, these are chronicle things that, I don't know, Rich might lead you to another area, but I'm telling you, Jim Leland, before he passes, I don't know how many cigarettes he smoked in his life, but I'm just saying he is a phenomenal human being in our life. And again, Rich will tell you more. Rich can tell you much more because he goes a lot deeper with Jim and understanding some things. But where you want to go with him is just phenomenal.
How old is Jim?
Jim has got to be 70. I'm saying 70. Is he 60? Let's wait. I got to think of my 50th again. So Jim must be about 76, 75.
Might be fun to interview him as well after talking with John Roy.
Yeah, he's an interesting cat.
Where does he live?
Pittsburgh.
Okay.
Yeah, he's never left. I mean, he works for Detroit as a special advisor. I would be interested if he would be able to, if he would want to sit down with you. I mean, he's that type of guy, but he's ADD. I don't know if he could sit there and it almost like you'd have to be with him to understand it, because he did a special with Bob Costas on MLB Network, and you could tell he's much more comfortable talking to you person to person than he is I mean, if he had to find Zoom over his computer, he'd go, Jesus fucking Christ, woman, what the hell am I doing here? What's going on? Zoom?
Okay. I mean, I'd have to go to him, and we'd have to walk and talk probably.
He's just so special, and it's just one of those deals where you might be surprised what you can do with this stuff. I mean, he's that instrumental in our game. He should be in the Hall of Fame, and he's not yet. He should be in the Hall of Fame. Anyway, I'm going to get a hold of Rich, and if Rich says okay, I'm going to forward your stuff to him, and hopefully maybe he can touch base with him.
Super. Gary, thank you so much.
Thanks for taking the time. I appreciate it.
And we'll talk next week.
Next week. You got it. Okay.
Have a wonderful, wonderful day. Bye-bye.
You too. Bye.